one of the first project documentaries that we made in 1964 is also the one that's probably been talked about more than any other. It even caused a stir at the time, if you remember the newspaper headlines. It was called The Glittering Mile, and it was about King's Cross. Well, since then, things have changed up at the Cross, as all things do. In fact, the new plan to redevelop the Cross and put a tunnel under it and a new highway through it may change its character quite considerably. But many things about King's Cross haven't changed and won't change. So here to remind you of what it was like then, and still is, in fact, here once again is The Glittering Mile.
Some call it Australia's Barbary Coast, and there are a few pirates there for sure. Others call it Sin City, and there's some of that around too. One Sydney alderman wants it cleaned up. Another says it's worth $1 million a year the way it is. If you can believe what you read about it, the inhabitants make their living out of baccarat, dope, witchcraft, prostitution, stripping, and selling each other salami. But you can't invent anything about the place that isn't partly true. The Cross is something that Sydney bears with a mixture of disapproval and delight. But you won't find it on any map, and there's no street sign that says King's Cross. It's a no-man's land with something for everyone. It has no boundaries to its name and no limits to its way of life. In fact, the Cross is not a place, but a state of mind. From its heart, you can go about half a mile in any direction before you run out of the lights into the darkness of the outside world. A half mile there and back. A glittering mile of dreams, delusions, hopes, and headaches. Where life comes out of an espresso machine, and you can have it any way you like it. King's Cross stands on top of a hill a mile or so east of the city of Sydney. Its population safely barricaded against the world of law, order, conformity and common sense in a monstrous jumble of buildings of every style and shape. Only one thing these buildings have in common. They're packed with people, even though most of them don't seem to venture out by daylight. In this one square mile live 100,000 people. That makes the Cross the most densely populated white area in the world. On the battlements of the Cross, the white flags of the downstairs armies flutter. There are few sentries on guard because the denizens of the Cross have survived many assaults on their citadel, and the enemy has always been repulsed. To the east, the Cross looks out on the gleaming waters of Elizabeth Bay and the harbour stretching towards the heads. Today, the gently sloping foreshores are crammed with flats and home units all the way up to the top of Maclay Street and the heart of the Cross. To the northwest, the Cross overlooks Woolloomooloo, with the jagged skyline of the city to the west. Everywhere you look, there is a sea of brick and stone washing around the base of the hill on which the Cross is built. It was not always so, of course. 130 years ago, there were windmills at the Cross at the top of William Street. Governor Macquarie named the area Henrietta Town after his wife, and ships from England tied up off the point as they waited to move into Sydney Cove. From the cove, an Aboriginal track ran south to where St. Mary's Cathedral now stands. Then turned east and followed the line of what is now William Street right up to the top of the hill. In 1813, the tree-lined bush track became William Street, named after William of England. Sir Thomas Mitchell, the Surveyor General, intended to curve the road to avoid the steep slope at the top. But while he was away from Sydney, it was built straight up the hill and gave the early horse-drawn traffic a difficult climb. From 1830 onwards, the area entered its age of elegance as the foreshores and Potts Point became the showplace of Sydney's fashionable way of life. The green slopes were divided into land grants for those who found favour with the governors of the day. And up went the mansions. Craig End, the home of Sir Thomas Mitchell, who fought King's Cross's first duel with pistols against Sir Stuart Donaldson, the first Premier of New South Wales. Sir Thomas Mitchell got a bullet through his whiskers, and his bullet went through Donaldson's hat. All that's left of Craig End now is the street named after the house. Greenough, which stood from 1831 until the 1920s, when it gave way to a block of flats. Orwell, built for the colony's first judge, Mr. Justice Stephen. In 1915, it vanished beneath the brick undergrowth of Orwell Street. Then there was Tusculum, which still stands after more than 130 years. Today it is penned in by blocks of flats, but despite conversions into a hospital, an officers' club for the American forces during the last war, and now a hotel, it lingers on and even maintains some of its old elegance. In 1825, there arrived in Sydney a man who was to leave his mark on King's Cross. He was the new colonial secretary, Alexander Maclay. In 1828, he was given a grant of 54 acres overlooking Elizabeth Bay. And there, Alexander Maclay built for his wife, Eliza, and their nine children, a house that has become a classic of early colonial architecture. In particular, the graceful, elliptical, cantilevered staircase in the entrance hall. Today, Elizabeth Bay House is converted into 16 flats, and the 54 acres garden has shrunk to less than a quarter of an acre. But even the encroaching flats and home units cannot shut out the view of the harbour that Alexander Maclay presented to his wife, Eliza. Maclay Street is named after Alexander Maclay, and the gates of Elizabeth Bay House used to be at the present junction of Maclay Street and Elizabeth Bay Road. To drive down this road to the house today, as the carriages used to clip-clop down the private driveway, is to realize the extent of Maclay's original property, granted in a more spacious age than ours. In 1875, houses had spilled down towards Rushcutters Bay, although big trees still fringed New South Head Road. From Rushcutters Bay, looking back towards the cross, there were plenty of trees to be seen, and the spire of St. John's Church on the skyline. This church was built in 1858, a faithful exercise in medieval Gothic. The old fire station followed in 1882 in Victorian immutable. Both church and fire station are still in business, although business is pretty slow at both places. The fire station stands at the only place which is actually entitled to call itself King's Cross, the junction of six roads at the top of William Street. And there's probably not one of the 100,000 inhabitants who know that it was originally called Queen's Cross. This name was bestowed on the junction by the Municipal Council in 1897 to mark Queen Victoria's Diamond Jubilee. But by 1905, confusion began to arise between Queen's Cross and Queen's Square in the city, so the name was changed to King's Cross. But there never has been a plaque or a street sign to mark the christening of Sydney's lustiest, fastest-growing area. For by the end of the century, the great estates were being cut up, and row upon row of terraced houses, in the English Victorian style, were being built in the parklands that once surrounded the mansions. As fast as the famous and the wealthy sold their properties, they were turned into rooms and apartments hotels and boarding houses. After the First World War, when trams and cars joined the horse-drawn carriages on the long climb up William Street to the cross, William Street itself had to be widened. The process took 10 years. When this picture was taken, the old post office still stuck halfway across the street up near the cross. By 1922, the cross had settled into its present familiar layout, although the neon signs and strip joints had yet to appear. But now the cross was entering the period that was to stamp its character forever. For this was when the cross went bohemian. In the narrow streets behind these buildings, writers and artists and their girlfriends crammed into tiny rooms to share the rent they didn't intend to pay anyway. The parties lasted for days, and so must the hangovers, after a drink like the King's Cross Express, which one inspired host dreamed up for his guests. It was mixed in a new garbage tin and consisted of whiskey, champagne, red wine, beer, gin, stout and lemonade, with raisins and sliced apples, brewed for several days and stirred with a broom handle. The queen of Bohemia in those days was Dulcie Deemer, whose favorite party outfit was a leopard skin. Dulcie still lives at the cross. She likes to sit now in the park among the old-timers dreaming in the sun. Dulcie Deemer, the queen of Bohemia, wears her title proudly as she talks with Suzanne Baker.
But what sort of things did you do to make you bohemian?
I don't know. That's hard to put into words, too. I always acted naturally. And I'm very fond of life. And whilst I was stage trained, I used to do, as a matter of course, the splits and the high kicks and things like that at our parties.
I see, did you drink much, or did you...
Oh, no. Well, people seem to think I did, but I never did. For instance, I was a hard-working person, a freelance journalist all that time, and I've never, but never, mixed drink with work. It's a very stupid thing to do. A lot of those I knew did, but I never did. If I had a shilling for every offer of a drink I've turned down the course of my bohemian life, I'd be very wealthy. I only drank at weekends when work was over and we happened to have a party. Then I had having a very hard head, thanks to my ancestry, I could drink a lot and didn't do any damage.
Do you think that the young people and the not so young people who enjoy coming to the cross these days could call themselves bohemians in the same way you called yourself a bohemian?
No, I do not. For the principal reason is that we people, we bohemians at the cross in those days, we're here because it was handy for towns. I say we could always walk in if we didn't have a fare, and because we get awfully cheap places to live in, little holes and corners in ancient mansions, all partitioned off, you know, just little holes and corners. You can get a little hole and corner for less than a quid a week. Well, those were the two important factors. That's what brought the artist crowd, who never have much money unless they succeed, up here with their girlfriends and hangers-on. They certainly, being in very old places, had atmosphere. It's something you can't describe. They had plenty of inconveniences and lots of bugs. Bugs were a trouble. One of my principal troubles at the cross was bugs. Other people had that too.
How did you deal with them?
The landlady was always dragging out the bed and dosing it in the backyard with kerosene. And the bed smelled bad, but for a while it kept the bugs down.
In the cross today, it's hard to realize that there was a time in the late 20s when razors were used for slashing faces, not shaving them. In the narrow back alleys, the razors flashed night after night as the gangs battled for control of the gambling and betting rackets. Eaton Avenue was affectionately known as Blood Gully after one gang battle there. Today, the lane is built over, the scars have healed, but some still remember. In the 30s came for the first time organized commercial nightlife. The first nightclub in the area providing music, drink, and grills was called the 50-50 Club, run by Phil the Jew. It was on the fourth floor of a building at the corner of William and Forbes Streets. The 50-50 Club has, of course, long gone from the premises. The early 30s, too, saw the influx of a new influence in this tea-drinking country, the coffee shop. At one time, there was only one coffee shop in the cross, the Arabian. After the war, with the influx of new Australians and the rush to visit the cross really set in, the nostalgic tones of the 30s gave way to the polyglot accents of a wider kind of world.
Hello.
of all the signs and symbols of change around the cross, nothing tells the story better than the stones of Darlinghurst Jail. Completed in 1841, it was built on the site of the old Woolloomooloo Stockade, a kind of overflow camp for the overcrowded Sydney jail in George Street. The centralized arrangement of buildings followed the plan of Philadelphia Prison in the United States. The massive outer walls were designed and supervised by Francis Greenway, the convict architect. The Supreme Court was built later, conveniently close by. The stone for the jail was quarried by convicts in Forbes Street, and every block bears a convict's mark. When a man had cut his quota, he could work for a free settler for money. In June 1841, the prisoners moved into their new home. 119 men marched up to Darlinghurst from the city, chained together, led by a notorious bushranger, Paddy Curran, and guarded by 55 policemen. Next day, 50 women prisoners followed, and eventually the number of women prisoners grew to more than 300. The executions began almost immediately in October 1841. At first, they were held outside in Forbes Street, but public protests had them moved back inside. Altogether, 75 men and one woman were hanged here, the last in 1908. Today, there are new tenants in the cell blocks of Darlinghurst Jail, the 9,000 students of the East Sydney Technical College, learning to be artists and sculptors, butchers and pastry cooks. It's a transformation scene that only the irreverent pantomime of King's Cross could provide. Students, as they stroll or sit in the sun, this setting is a world away from the scene that haunted Henry Lawson, who spent some time in this jail for not supporting his wife.
They shut a man in the 4x8 with a 6-inch slit for air, 23 hours of the 24 to brood on his virtues there. The dead stone walls and the iron door close in like iron bands on eyes that have followed the distant haze out there on the level lands. The great round church with its volume of sound where we dare not turn our eyes. They take us there from our separate hells to sing of paradise. The high church service swells and swells where the tinted Christs look down. It's easy to see who's weary and faint and weareth the thorny crown. You get the gold dust into your throat. Your skin goes the dead jail white. You get the jail whine in your voice and in every letter you write. And into your eyes comes the bright jail light. Not the glare of the world's distraught. Not the haunted look nor the guilty look. But the awful look of the court.
King's Cross has an immediate appeal to people. But how does it strike an architect with its careless, carefree jumble of styles, like the pages of a torn-up book on building through the ages? One of Sydney's best-known architects and an authority on the buildings of this country is Morton Herman, who has his studio at the Cross just across the street from the old fire station.
What about this hodgepodge? Doesn't it help in some way to contribute to the rather colourful character of the Cross?
I couldn't agree more. That's exactly what it does do. It's partly the layout, partly the casual way the street formed together, and of course the planting. Trees in the streets have a very great influence on what character a district has. Very many of the buildings in the Cross are old buildings. Even just behind us there is a weatherboard cottage right in the middle of the Cross.
You know, the Cross, with all its sort of narrow, twisting streets, is quite different from any other part of Sydney. Why do you think it grew up in this way?
Oh, well, it was a dormitory section for Sydney in the early days, and all dormitory suburbs get more and more closely settled, and many of the streets, which are now streets, were really lanes leading up to the coach houses and stables behind the great houses.
Are there any old stables still around?
No, I never found one yet.
What do you think, personally, is the most attractive street or area here?
Oh, I think the Clay Street, by any manner of means, it's got a mixture of the old and the new in architecture. It's got the beautiful trees and somehow almost a Parisian atmosphere about the Clay Street.
As you've already said, there's some pretty decrepit buildings and areas here. Would you like to see wholesale reconstruction?
Well, frankly, there'd be two answers. As an architect, I would say yes. As a person, I'd say no. I think half the charm of the Cross is its funny, rambling old character. But some of the fine old terraces I'd like to see preserved because they have a useful life. You know, a lot of people think there is no good architecture in the Victorian period, but there is. Particularly around the Cross, you'll find splendid examples of it. Working up here, I find it's more like a village atmosphere, despite its metropolitan character generally. But the people are very much like villages. Everybody knows everybody, friendly, and it's the most happy atmosphere altogether.
And on a Saturday morning at the Cross, the people come out into the streets of their village to do their shopping, take the sun, to remember the past, or perhaps to try and forget last night. This is just one of the faces that the Cross shows to outsiders. It speaks many tongues and conveys many messages to those who are willing to listen.
News came out over the radio that President Kennedy had died. I guess that most of you were shocked and found it just hard to believe that this could happen. Now, at one time, there was a man who went out to preach to folk, just like we go out along the streets and the highways and the byways. As he went out to preach to the folk, they found it hard to believe what he had to say. And you know, men and women today find it hard to believe that the message of the gospel is something that's true and real. I'd like to sing about the peace that the Lord Jesus can bring, and the peace that the person who trusts in the Savior will have when they receive him and when they go on to be in heaven one day.
As the day.
Cross by Day is one face of this crowded square mile. But with the coming of evening, the denizens of the Cross prepare in their various ways for the hours of darkness. One day finishes here at sunset, and another begins, as the Cross lifts up its other face, and the mile begins to glitter. The night begins in the afternoon. For the waiters in the empty Silver Spade Room at the Chevron Hotel. For Wayne Newton, just in from Las Vegas, preparing for his opening night.
Second balcony was a place we meet. Second seat, Gold Dutch Street. You were sweet, Danke Schön. Darling, Danke Schön. Save those lies. Darling, don't explain. I confess, that's not all, Danke Schön. Darling, Danke Schön. Ah, save those lives. Darling, don't explain. Now I can see hearts carved on a tree. Letters intertwined for all time. Yours and mine, that was fine.
As the night wears on, fully half those at work in the Cross are engaged in feeding the other half. In the Chevron kitchens, the battle to keep up with the orders follows its nightly course. Tasty Tasty, possibly the most famous establishment of elegant eating in the Southern Hemisphere, the late supper diners are dropping in after the theater. And they'll go on dropping in all night, for the Hasty Tasty never closes. But if there's one thing the Cross prides itself on, it's the ability to provide you with anything you want to eat or drink at any time, at any price, in any kind of surroundings, against any kind of musical background, even out of the past. Thank you. What do these throngs of people still walking up and down the cross at midnight come here for? What do they hope to find? Pat Condon asked them.
What do you think of the cross?
Well, I think it's gone off a lot lately. It used to be a place that one could meet a few interesting people of there with a very, very sort of bohemian point of view. But now one gets a lot of tourists, you see, and it's sort of, it's good for the sort of, I suppose, for the business people, but I find it a bit sort of crooked when people come up and say, well, look, you know, looking to see some of the sinful bohemians, you know. They think, well, you know, well, we'll come up and have a look at the sinful beatniks and see what's going on. Well, I mean, it's sort of, well, a bit crooked, a bloke comes up and says, ah, there's a beetle or something like this, you know. I say, well, look, he's got long hair or he's got a beard, and I think, well, you know, automatically I think he's a sinful bohemian or an artist or a, you know, degenerate, a moral degenerate or something like this. And not that I mind myself, I have a fairly broad point of view on things. I mean, I'll talk about anything at all. I mean, here we have a stripper going to work, as you can see on the telly. Well, I mean, this sort of thing, I mean, some people might say, well, she's a woman of loose morals or something of this nature. Well, to heck with all that. You take a person, not what they look like, not what their appearances is, you take what their thoughts are, you take what their outlook on life is. I mean, she might be a Zen Buddhist, she might be an existentialist, she might be anything. The whole trouble with the world today is intolerance. And if people were tolerant of one another and prepared to give 5 minutes of their time to listen to the other person's point of view, well, the world would be a lot better place today.
Well, I like the bohemian people here. I don't think it's the people that live here. I think it's the people that come to see the other people.
A magnificent place to live in.
And you do live here?
I've lived here for 40 years.
And how do you like the people who live in the cross?
I love every one of them.
Hello, darling.
And it's got a lot of creeps around here, I know that for one thing. We get pestered all the time walking from one club to another.
Yeah, what do you do?
I'm a dancer at the Pink Pussycat in Staccato.
Well, you're just on your way to work now?
No, coming home.
Are you all finished?
Yes.
And do you live at the cross?
No, I'm from the North Shore.
I like the cross, really. It, basically, I knew it when I was a boy at 20, and I can't say really that it's changed very much in that time.
Do you like the people?
Yeah, it's the most interesting part of it. They're all tourists, pseudo beats.
Well, I think they should have about 15 policemen patrolling the streets here until about 4 o'clock in the morning, and King's Cross could become a very pleasant place.
I don't particularly like it or dislike it. It's a curiosity shop, as far as I'm concerned. It's something to do with people who have got no homes and nowhere to go to, I see their own little egos, and they criticize others as they want to be criticized themselves, I think.
We're over here from New Zealand. Winchester's a place. We come over here, tend to play open rugby.
What do you think of King's Cross, though?
As far as I find, it's a big crowd here, and we haven't much to look around yet. But it's magnificent, the sight, the people up and down the street.
What do you think about the people?
Well, as far as I can see, they're all friendly, they all speak, they all know, all those boys with us are all New Zealanders, and they speak to us. And
have you been into any of the restaurants and the clubs?
I haven't. We're just on our way there.
Where are you going?
We're just going to have a look at the trapeze here and the show in here, and all the rest of the boys. I like to...
What do you expect when you get in the trip, John? Have you been to one before?
No, it's the first one I've been in.
What do you anticipate?
I don't know. It's what we see, isn't it?
Not everybody is happy, even at the cross. Sandor Berger, the poet from Hungary, finds a lot wrong with things the way they are and sits in a doorway at the cross every night to draw attention to this situation.
What are you protesting about?
To sum my protests up, against man's inhumanity to men.
Do you have trouble with the public? Did they get past?
Well, naturally, I encounter all types of people. I'm glad to say that in the overwhelming majority, they are civil and nice. Of course, I do meet some offensive types occasionally, but I consider that is just part of the price one has to take for being an individual in our present society.
Seek, they say, and ye shall find. And around the cross you'll find almost anything you can think of if you seek hard enough. If it's company you're after, there are plenty of girls at the cross. The place is full of girls, coming and going. It's hard to understand what keeps them so busy all night long. And if you can't make a suitable acquaintance, you can be catered for at places where the girls are provided to please you, but you mustn't touch. The manager of the Pink Pussycat is known around the cross as Last Card Louie. Yes.
Now, you've been in this business for some time. What do you think it's yourself?
Well, I've been in it a very, very long time. As a matter of fact, I've seen the show 39,000 times. It's just one of those things. I don't know what to think about it, to tell you the truth. It's a good job. I like the atmosphere about it and the excitement about it. That I have one day that I'll get out of and do something good.
If you find all this commonplace, what about a bit of black magic? There's not as much about it there used to be, in the days when Rosalind Norton had this notice on her door. And a chemist hung out a notice one night, gone to mass, black, in half an hour. But Rosalind Norton herself, the most famous witch in Sydney, still has faith in her powers. If you look in any night at the Apollyon Lounge at the Cross, Apollyon, by the way, was the archangel of the bottomless pit, you might find Rosalind Norton as Suzanne Baker did.
Very, people always associate you with witchcraft, and some people even say they think you are a witch. What have you got to do?
Well, I say think about that. They're round lagging behind the publicity that I've had, that's all I think. Yes, I'm certainly a witch.
Have you always been a witch?
Yes, always.
How did you first realize that you were a witch?
First thing was when I was seven, I went up to turn some blue dots appeared on my knee. I could make out the colors, but I noticed them, wondered what they were. I went to or anything, I forgot them. And funny enough, they're the one of the traditional witches' marks. Two or three blue or red dots to get along the skin. It's one of the old traditional witch marks.
You found that out afterwards, after you had...
Oh, years later. It appeared when I was 7 years old. But I know how old I was. It was the year we came over from New Zealand.
Is it difficult being a witch?
Yeah, it's the easiest thing in the world. It'd be much more difficult not to be.
See, what does one have to do to be initiated into the ritual?
Oh, first of all, you have to be sick. I mean, thousands of teenagers, well, not thousands, no, it's an exaggeration, but several hundred teenagers at least several hundred, over the years. So it's all come along to me, oh, I want to be a witch and so forth, do anything. Oh, no, God, I've been on the top of my own there. I mean, they're obviously just kids looking for a thrill. It's got to be somebody who's really serious about and who's got the talent. They've got a natural gift, rather like a gift of drawing or painting. And if they really do want it, they're serious about it, and they persevere. And sooner or later, they're put through a series of tests. What are these tests, for instance?
One of the tests, I can't tell you, because they're part of the workings of the cult.
Are you sorry you didn't have, or you don't have a life that, say, ordinary people have, like getting married and having children?
Oh, gosh, and now I couldn't stand it. I'd go mad. Or go straight. I don't know which I can't.
The traditional form of accommodation of the cross is the single room, whether it's called a bedsitter, a flat, or if even the estate agent hasn't the nerve to go that far, a flatette. For the young and eager, it can be a pad in paradise. For pensioners, old people, unsuccessful people, hopeless people, the single room at the cross, set as it is in an overcrowded honeycomb and echoing with noise all day and night, can be as lonely as an outpost on the moon. For the inhabitants of the dark back rooms, the cross provides an extra lung. Fitzroy Gardens, where the sparkling puffball of the El Alamein fountain blows in the wind, and the pigeons are fat enough to attract attention from nearby restaurateurs. Everything is free in the Fitzroy Gardens, even the weekly operatic recital provided by singers eager to lend the cross a bit of tone. Some residents living in flats overlooking the little park, lunchtime opera, gospeling, and road mending all come under the same infernal heading, noise. Noise that has been growing worse, they say, with every year that passes. Dorothy Dunkley's flat overlooks the park, and she spends much of her time complaining to the newspapers, the council, even to the police, but without, it seems, much success.
The police are very good. When we tell them about a bashing or something, they eventually come. And I suppose someone takes the bodies, I don't know. It's too nasty to watch. But we need a permanent police control here. Then on Sunday nights, the one night of the week that we have in peace, strange religious sects come here with a van, and for 2 hours, one night was 3 hours, they give us an amplified plea, remember that Christ died for us, which we all realize very gratefully without their help. Now, one night, they had their music with them, and the music consisted of a steel guitar, a lovely modern instrument, and drums, and a trumpet, and this was amplified. It went on from 7:30 till 10:30. Now, we sent for the police, and they'd come over, but they're terribly nice men, up to date. They just stood there and I presume being converted.
Periodically, the cross gets its share of publicity, but nothing seems to change. Some of the residents, like Marion Dreyer, a writer, have made so many complaints without effect about the goings-on in the streets around them that they've started keeping records. These are Marion Dreyer's photographs of what she calls doorway prostitution opposite her flat.
I see, Marion, you've been keeping a diary of these complaints of yours. Would you like to read some of them out?
Oh, well, they're not all of them. It's just the more spectacular ones. For instance, on the 1st of January at 9:45, the vice squad came up and took about 8 people from the building opposite. They'd had an all-night party, and the language was something, well, really. on Monday the 13th at 4:15 that morning, there was a girl sitting on a window ledge in the building opposite wearing a sailor's hat.
Is that all?
Yes. And then Monday, January the 13th, the vice squad were down three times. They were practically running the shuttle service, clearing people out. At 4:10 on the 25th of January, there was a woman screaming to help. And I got through to emergency. And even on emergency, they could hear her screams, although we're 35 feet above street level.
One frequently heard demand around the cross, by law-abiding inhabitants that is for more police in the area, and particularly policemen on the beat at night, where now they patrol in cars. So far, efforts to clean up the cross have lacked much success, perhaps because of a noticeable lack of public support for such a campaign. The views of many people in Sydney are expressed by Alderman Con Wallace, part owner of the Hasty Tasty, as he sits on the roof of a hotel in which he also has an interest.
And I have a feeling or a theory, call it what you will, that the cross in modern day society, where people live at the tempo and demand the entertainments and diversities that they've grown to expect by the advent of television, bringing entertainment right into their own homes, by picture shows and modern novels, that the cross is a way of release for them. It takes, in my opinion, the place in mass society, the same role as the couch does in the psychiatrist's chambers in Macquarie Street.
What do you think about the gambling and prostitution in the cross?
Well, I would say that wiser men and people clothed in more authority than the city council have endeavoured to eliminate both those forms of what could be called offbeat pleasures by some people, and they've failed. Now, I think the task would be beyond any authority in a seaboard town such as Sydney to attempt to outlaw that sort of thing. You see, you can legislate to make a thing illegal, but you can't make it unpopular by legislation.
Far from becoming more respectable, in fact, in some ways, the cross is becoming more extreme in the attractions that it offers. Never before, even at the height of its bohemian period in the 20s, has the cross had public entertainment like the all-male reviews, which, as the sideshow Barker puts it, have to be seen to be believed. A few years ago, an all-male review like Les Girls would have been out of the question in Sydney, as it would in most places where people like the differences between the sexes to be clear and obvious. Today it's part of the King's Cross scene. Technically, the performers at Les Girls are female impersonators, but they're adding a startling new dimension to an old form of entertainment. As Peter introduces, to an audience still understandably bewildered, performers like John and Roger and Charlie, Pat Condon goes backstage into the kitchen to talk to one of the stars of the show, whose stage name is Carlotta.
Carlotta, what is your real name?
My real name?
Ricky Barrow.
Ricky.
Ricky.
What do you decide? Are you doing anything besides working at Lego?
Well, actually, before I was working at Lego, I was a hairdresser. I am a fully qualified hairdresser. But at the moment, I'm making more money doing this, and I'm saving to go overseas, so that's it. I'm here, and the hairdressing's going to wait until I come back, and then maybe I'll take it up again.
Is this your own hair?
This, yes, it's part of my act.
Well, working as a hairdresser, does your client know that, you know, this is your own hair and so on? Did you wear your hair the way you do it?
Oh, no, my hair was short when I was working as a hairdresser. My hair grows very quickly, and it took me about 4 months to grow this length, and when I take hairdressing up again, off it comes.
Nice. Do you ever wear men's clothes?
Yes. During the day, I do.
All the time?
Yes.
Now, working as a female impersonator at the club, do you have any trouble with the audience?
No. As I said before, in Sydney, we've had no trouble whatsoever here. Mm. I mean, you might get somebody who might be a bit drunk in the audience, and then they might fling off a bit, but really, you won't get many, bluntly gigs in Sydney. But I've worked in Melbourne, and the people down there, they sort of say, they didn't like it at all. I only worked there for a week, and when I came back, the club was closed up after I left.
Now, you did say that you come to work just in men's clothes.
Yes.
Now, if this wasn't against the law to appear in public dressed in women's clothes, would you normally dress in women's clothes if this was the case?
Well, that's a hard question. Actually, at the moment, no. I mean, let's face it, I was born a boy, and that's the way it is. I mean, I'm doing this as a job, no other thing.
That's the way it is at King's Cross. But this is the other face of the cross. Not so harmless, not so friendly, not so easy to forget. The night face that is alternately laughing and scowling, seeking comfort or forgetfulness, sensation or satisfaction. Only here, the search for something, whatever it is, goes on all through the night.
This is 2KY in Sydney. You're listening to the All Night Show. The time is just on 21 minutes after 5 o'clock. A call to Dave and Kevin of North Sydney Leagues Club. You know this one, Dave and Kevin?
Around the corner, any cozy little corner. Love is just around the corner when I'm around you. I'm a sentimental mourner, and I couldn't be forlorner when you keep me in a corner just waiting for you. Venus de Milo was noted for her charm. Strictly between us, you're cuter than Venus, and what's more, you've got arms. So let's go cuddle in a corner any cozy little corner. Love is just around the corner when I'm around you.
At last the sky begins to lighten. The search is over for the time being. Perhaps for some, it is just about to begin all over again. Denizens are stirring in their hilltop citadel, surrounded as always by a world that looks, as it sleeps in the dawn light, as grey and solid and respectable and dull as it is, by comparison with Sydney's glittering miles.